inaugural lecture of this university. The lecture will be delivered by no other person than Professor Alaba, Adenuga, the Dean Faculty of Education. I would like to recognize some important personalities that are here with us. Please stand up, please. The procession is being led by the members of the manual of the university, closely followed by the Dean of Faculty, the Dean of Student Affairs, then we have the Dean of Faculty of Art, Professor Rubu May, and the Dean of Social Sciences, Professor I.A. Atifiloyi, Dean has been a management scientist, Professor Shomoye, and the Dean Clinical, Professor Olatunji, the Dean Basic Medical, Professor Adepawo, and the Dean of Environmental, Professor Delebadijo, and we have the Dean of Engineering, in person of Dr. Olatunji Akeyemi, and we have Professor Olabisi, and of course Professor K from Greek, Professor Tolu of the 1918 Science, BCA Taiwo Provost, College of Greek, Professor Tani Provost Oaks, Professor G. Adenuga, PG School, the Bursars, Mr. Semin Makide, the Registrar, Mrs. Oshusa, and Vice Chancellor, Professor Gani Olatunji Olatunji. Please be seated. Now, it's my pleasure and special privilege to invite the University Registrar, who will thereafter invite the Vice Chancellor to declare the 84th Inaugural Lecture of Olabisi Onabanjo University, entitled Managing the Managers, the Counselor's Mission, to be delivered by Professor Razak Alaba Adenuga. Madam Registrar.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I have the honor to call on the Vice Chancellor, Professor Gani Olatunji Olatunde, to declare the 84th inaugural lecture.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to declare the 84th inaugural lecture open. Thank you.
Permit me also call on the Vice Chancellor to read the citation of the inaugural lecture.
Of Professor Razak Alaba Adenuga. Professor Razak Alaba Adenuga was born into the Fushegbuwa ruling house in 1963. He had his primary education at Otubu Memorial Primary School at Akwebi Ijebuode. Akwebi Ijebuode proceeded to Muslim Commercial School, Imepe, Ijebuode, between 1976 and 1980. He bagged his teacher's grade 2 certificate in 1983 as one of the pioneer students of the Teacher Training College, Orne, Ijebu, Waterside.
He taught briefly at the St. John Primary School of Sosa between 1983 and 1984 before getting admission into Ogun State College of Education in Jebude to study history / Islamic studies, where he obtained the NCE in 1987. Immediately proceeded to Ogun State University, now Olabisi Onabanjo University, where he bagged a Bachelor of Arts Education honors degree with the second class upper division in guidance and counseling in 1990. After his mandatory 1 year National Youth Service Corps program at the Government Secondary School, Maiduguri, Borno State in 1991, he was admitted to the University of Ibadan for his M.Ed. degree program in guidance and counseling in 1992 and PhD degree program in 2004. Professor Adenuga joined the services of Ogun State University, now Olabisi Onabanjo University, Agowi, in May 1992 as a graduate assistant in the Department of Educational Foundations and Management, and through dint of hard work and perseverance, rose to the position of Professor of Counseling and Personal Psychology in 2010. Professor Razak Alaba Adenuga has served the university in various capacities, in both academic and administrative positions. He is the current Dean for Faculty of Education, Chairman University Security Committee, and a member of the university management. In the past, he had been the Director, Institute of Education, Head, Department of Educational Foundations and Management, Head, Department of Education, Head, Department of Educational Foundation and Counseling, Sub-Dean for Undergraduate Senate Representative of Business Committee, Member Student Welfare Committee, Member University Senate, Member Committee of Provost and Deans, Member University Postgraduate Management Board, Member University Guidance and Counseling Committee, and several other university committees. Professor Adenuga has taught various courses in Educational Foundation, Guidance and Counseling, Psychology and Personal Management in the Faculty of Social and Management Sciences. To date, he has successfully supervised several undergraduate students' projects, master's degrees, dissertations, and well over 26 doctoral theses. His academic experience could be attested to by over 80 scholarly publications in both international and national journals. Professor Razak Alaba Adenuga has served as external examiner to several universities in Nigeria. Among these are the University of Ibadan, the University of Lagos, Lagos State University, Ekiti State University, Taishola University of Education, the Polytechnic Ibadan, Taishola College of Education, Omo, and McPherson University, Ajebo, in Ibadan. Professor Alaba Adenuga belongs to several professional bodies. He's a member, Counseling Association of Nigeria, member, Association of Professional Counselors, member, National Association of Professional Educators, member, National Association of Bilingual Educators, Washington, D.C., member, Learning Disability Association of America, and member, Association of Educational Educators in Ghana. He has served as Editor-in-Chief to African Journal of Research in Personnel and Counseling Psychology, and Journal of Education Focus is a recipient of several awards and distinctions. Outside his core academic activities, Professor Alaba Adenuga is the chairman of Olabisi Onabanjo University Islamic Center Building Committee, President Olabisi Onabanjo University Senior Staff Club, and Vice President Ijebuode Club. As a man of culture and tradition, he was honored with many chieftain titles, among which are Otoba Onigegeara of Obiako and Otoba Pimokuyi of Ilodo Kingdom. Professor Adenuga is married to Dr. Mrs. Falila Titilayo Adenuga, Ni-Avis, a senior lecturer in the Department of English, Taishuna University of Education, Ijago. And their marriage is blessed with wonderful children and grandchildren. To invite Professor Rasad Alaba Adenuga to deliver the 84th inaugural lecture titled Managing the Managers, the Counselors Nation. I wish you happy listening. Thank you.
Deputy Vice Chancellor, Principal of the University, Defeating members of the University Governing Council, Provost and Deans, Professors and Heads of Departments, the Royal Highnesses here present, my Lord Commissioner and Temporal, distinguished guests from sister universities and tertiary institutions, gentlemen of the press, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, and the great art. The greatest of the greatest art. The greatest Nigerian students. Thank you. Mr. Vice Chancellor, it is with great pleasure and gratitude to Almighty Allah that I stand before this august gathering to deliver the 84th inaugural lecture of our great university, 18th in the Faculty of Education and 5th in the Department of Educational Foundations and Counseling, today, 24th July 2018. Sincerely, it is still like a miracle to me when I look back with nostalgia my background as a product of modern and commercial schools, whose products are mostly seen to be primary school or secondary school teachers, or at most, technical college products. My desire after my secondary education was to go to the technical college, Jewodi, to study bricklaying and concreting. But I was offered admission to study woodwork and machinery, which I did not have interest in. I later contacted my late uncle, Alaba Okunlashote, lovely, who was then the chairman of the governing council, Ijebuode Technical College. He offered me a job as a clerk at the Shoka Space Industry with the promise that the following year he will influence my admission into the same school to read and prefer course of study. Alas, Mr. Bassa, as fate will have it, after my second day at Shoka Industry, one of my father's favorite elder brothers, Tayo Lukoi, of blessed memory, then a secondary school teacher, was to travel to the Teachers Union College on the Jebu Waterside with my father's car, and he asked me to accompany him to the school. When we got there, I met about six of my classmates in secondary school as pioneer students of their school. There and then, I changed my mind that I was not going to take a college again, and that I would join them to be teacher. Distinguished audience, the rest is history. Today, Mr. Vice Chancellor, this background, I went through all the structure of teacher education, except absolute certificate in education. For more than six times, I sat for GCE with the determination that I was not going to combine my results to gain admission into the university. Obviously, university, now left of the was not my choice of university, neither was education my choice of course. I applied for law at the Yale University of Fife, but was offered admission to study history. One Mr. Wodu, who was a staff in the university and an in-law to Professor Richard before, at Palermo Settlement, advised my father that I should change my university to Ogun State University and that he will talk to the vice chancellor to allow me to study law. As Ori will have it again, that was done. And I was admitted to read history with the promise to change to law. Just a few weeks after my crossover to the State University, the Senate decided that no change of course should be allowed again. Meanwhile, I had completed my national certificate in education with history and Islamic studies at the then it was taken education, now Tashiba University in Japan. So when the decision was taken, my family friend, the same lecturer with Ukwa, introduced me to Professor Titi Azan, who was then Dr. Titi Azan and the head, Department of Educational Foundations and Management. Dr. Azan then advised me to cross the education and apply for right entry since I had my NCU. I quickly wrote the application and it was granted. And I then moved to history education, 200 level. Professor Azan also convinced me to change to guidance and counseling and assured me that I was going to enjoy it more than history. Without wasting time, I changed to guidance and counseling as one of the members of second set. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, this is the outcome of Professor Azan's counseling. Today, Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I am proud and fulfilled to stand before you as a counselor and a personnel psychology expert. My choice of topic, managing the manager, the counselor's mission, was born out of the myriad of problems that every human individual is confronted with every day, which is affecting everything about our development, growth, and stability. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, human beings are the most complex and the most dynamic resources to manage, and the process of managing them is daily tasking and Herculean. Managing people starts from the home and ends up in the society via the various human organizations and setups. Human beings plan, organize, and execute all activities in life, and as individuals, we must understand the basic fact that no individual is perfect, neither an island nor indispensable. Hence, every organization that deals with people at work must first try to understand their nature, knowing full well that they are the movers and shakers of everything that happens in life. Managing ourselves is a joint venture that everybody must be into. All of us are leaders in our own right, but are we leading like we want to be led? Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, leadership determines followership as they both emanate from the same society. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, my task in this lecture is to address the following and relate them to the title of this inaugural lecture without losing sight of their contributions to the process of managing people. Meaning and nature of guidance and counseling, basic assumptions about human nature, common sense and psychology, human resources management functions, roles, skills, and personal behavior. Counselor as human resources manager, managing people, managing the adults and children, the role of communication and literacy skills in managing people, guidance and counseling, and psychological health, conclusion and recommendations. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, guidance and counseling has no universal accepted definition, but for the purpose of this lecture, three definitions will be discussed with the view to bringing about the relevance to this inaugural lecture. So, a layman, guidance could be described as a way of directing people, showing the way by piloting and advising. But, Shasha and Misto, let's see, define guidance as a process of assisting an individual to understand himself and the world. Whereas, when he and Adenuga and himself, define guidance as helping services which help the individual within and outside the school setting to realize their fullest potential emotionally, morally, socially, academically, and vocationally. Counseling, on the other hand, is a term that has attracted the attention of the professional helpers to the extent that various states of opinion have been expressed to define the concept. The term has been used to denote a wide range of procedures, including behavioral adjustment, assisting in making appropriate vocational, educational, and personal decisions. But Lutcher defined a counselor as a person who helps an individual to respond to the influences in his environment. It further assists him to establish some personal meaning for his goals and values for further behavior. To tie that, he approached it from two angles. The first, according to him, is the central purpose of counseling, which is to facilitate wise choices and decisions. According to the second, his central purpose is to promote adjustment or mental health. Much more interestingly, Patterson attempted to define counseling by stating what counseling is not. And among Patterson's position is that counseling is not giving of information, though information may be given in counseling. Counseling is not giving us advice, suggestions, and recommendations. And counseling is not influencing attitude, belief, or behavior by means of persuading, leading, or convincing, no matter how incorrectly, subtly, or painlessly. Counseling is not influencing the of behavior, admonishing, warning, threatening, compelling, without the use of physical force or coercion. And of course, counseling is not selection and assignment of individual for interview. The nature of counseling, according to Patterson, is to be found in the following characteristics. Counseling is concerned with influencing voluntary behavioral changes on the part of the client or counselor. The purpose of counseling is to provide conditions that facilitate voluntary change in behavior. And of course, as in all relationships, limitations are imposed on the counseling by counseling goals that are influenced by the counselor's values and philosophy. It's listening. The counselors understand the client, and counseling is conducted in privacy, and the discussion is confidential. Basic assumptions about human nature. Naturally, every worker within an industrial setting has one or two problems to cater for every day, and these problems, either directly or indirectly, affect their performances. Worse still, majority of workers carry these problems to the work environment and subsequently transfer or display aggressive behavior to co-workers. This kind of problem will not only affect the performances of such staff, but will also create disharmony among workers. Hence, the need for the industrial labor relations and the counselor, as the case may be, to have thorough understanding of this assumption and to act promptly in the work environment. These assumptions are the principle of individual differences, rationality and emotionality, constraints of attitude and perceptions, and sociability and interdependence. The characteristics of human nature that is universally acknowledged is the fact that no two individuals are the same in their level of intelligence, attitude, interest, physical strength, manner and dexterity, knowledge, skills, motivation, personality traits, and other aspects of human activities. The individual difference in mental and physical abilities have broad implications for organization or establishment. Little wonder, Abatelis, a counseling psychologist, once stated that any event in life is determined by the interpretation of that event, and that nothing is good or bad, but our thinking and judgment make it to be either good or bad. However, Mr. Vasan Salosa, there is no one-to-one relationship between ability and productivity. Differences in motivation, experience, and work habits may result in many persons with high native potential performing below the level of others whose attitudes are marginal for the task in question. Rationality and emotionality. It is enough fact that in Nigeria, most especially in the Yoruba land, people enjoy shifting blame for their misdeeds on others, and hardly anything happens naturally with the Yoruba in particular and Africa in general. One foreign writer once stated that reasoning is alien and emotion is African. He went forward to say that Africans only provide reasons for their actions. Rather, somebody somewhere is responsible for their misdeed, even if a man of 100 years died, somebody killed the man. Sigmund Freud, a renowned psychologist, once described this type of attitude as a defensive mechanism to cover up our deeds. He gave rationalization and suppression and some other factors where the student will drill a course and say the lecturer doesn't know how to teach. Or you'll be dismissed from work because of your lackadaisical attitude and say they didn't like me in that organization. Today, it is mostly assumed that employees do not always behave rationally, at least in an economic sense. They sometimes go on strike in order to demonstrate their power and independence, even when they know full well that they cannot recover the economic losses. During such strike, they lose a lot of things, but to them, they are fighting for their rights. Constraints of attitude and perception. It is significant that behavior and expectations are strongly influenced by what a person believes to be the truth. An individual feels responsible for his actions when such actions are satisfying. In fact, people sometimes feel strongly that on a deep or conscious level, they develop intense feelings of guilt when they fail to live up to their self-expectations. They are real, regardless of any awareness or philosophical argument to the contrary. The fact that they hold others responsible for their action, too, is further evidence that for practical purposes, people committed to that very lofty view of humanity, which say that the individual's capacity for choosing between alternatives and for assuming responsibility for himself for his behavior. Organization cannot function optimally without this pragmatic assumption. No one sees the entire world as it really is. Everyone has a point of view that serve as a filter through which the external world is viewed. Voices that view people that listen might see them as not committed to their work. And of course, voices that see them as very hardworking will continue to provide enabling environment for them to function, sociability and interdependence. Human beings are social animals, and no one can be alone. Rather, one depends on others to have a fulfilling life. Rather, there's need for employees to appreciate the fact that human beings are inherently social beings and must be provided with the environment that will make provision for this. Employees should be free with their employers to discuss on basic issues about the progress and attainment of the national goals. Human relations expert or counselor should make the management members and heads of department to listen to the problems of their subordinates with a view to rendering assistance without altering the functions of the organization. Social needs take a variety of forms: the need for companionship, the need for support in doing one's work, and for someone with whom to communicate in order to relieve personal frustration and work stimulated boredom. But social needs have even deeper meaning in work situations. There is a need to understand and relate to this informal group as well as to individual employee. Employee cannot be treated as if their needs are alike. Everyone has certain primary needs: self-respect, clothing, and the approval of others. But even these needs vary greatly in intensity. As a person goes about satisfying these needs, new ones emerge, such as the need for achievement, recognition, and the need to engage in certain interesting activities. Mr. Vassan Salosa, managers these days assume so many things, and in some cases, expect their staff to display the same level of intelligence, or at least use their discretion in some areas. Alas, it is not so. Most intelligent managers expect the same understanding and intelligence from their staff, which is not common. Hence, the proper understanding of the psychology of common sense. Common sense and psychology. Mr. Vassan Salosa, the concept of common sense is not alien to counselors, nor to this gathering, but to professional and personal psychologists, there is nothing like common sense. Permit me to quote Plato at this juncture. According to Plato, knowledge is acquired, and wisdom is the gift from God. And whomever God loves, combine the two, knowledge and wisdom. Little wonder then, the Yoruba people will say, this boy is knowledgeable, but lacks wisdom. Common sense is good sense, and the ability to see things as they are, and doing things as they ought to be. The ability to read one's emotions, and be better equipped to assess one's level of emotional maturity, are essential qualities that managers should possess. This involves keeping descriptive emotions and impulse in check. Social competence is the competencies that determine how we handle relationships, sensing others' thoughts, feelings, and intentions, listening openly and sending convincing messages, negotiating and resolving disagreements amicably, the ability to interpret human actions, gestures, and speech patterns in foreign language or foreign culture is called cultural intelligence. A person with high cultural intelligence quickly analyzes an unfamiliar cultural situation and then responds appropriately. Mr. Vassan Salosa, ability to manage other people's anger is one of the human relation challenges that managers are facing now. However, psychologist Rhys Brandon Agoo suggests that the following skills can be learned and applied to any human organization where anger threatens to damage a relationship. One, recognize and accept the other people's anger. The simple recognition of the intense feelings of someone who is angry does a lot to diffuse the situation. In a calm voice, you might say, I can see that you are angry with me. So, with your own anger. To express your own anger or become defensive, we only create another barrier to emotional healing. When you respond to the angry person, keep your voice tone very soft. Keep in mind, your physical induction, the soft answer turns away from. Give the angry person feedback. After venting feelings and discussing specific details, the angry person will expect a response. Briefly paraphrase what seems to be the major concerns of the angry person and express a desire to find ways to resolve the problem. If you are at fault, accept the blame for your action and express a sincere apology. Psychologists agree that intelligent quotients tend to be stable throughout life span. What emotional content is learnable and an increased throughout one's lifespan. Because I hope for that is Mr. Pastor Solosa. What we see clearly that the concept of common sense is not common. Hence, managers should endeavor to treat each staff as a unique individual and must also stop comparing one staff to the other. In fact, the brilliant or highly intelligent managers always use themselves as templates to judge others. This will be stopped because of the principle of individual differences. Managers always relate with the staff as unique individuals with peculiar characteristics, hence the need to understand human resources principles. Human resources management, organizational behavior, personnel management, and business psychology are used interchangeably in this lecture to promote the same things as all of them strive to study human behavior at work, home, or in any social sector. Adenuga and Armstrong define human resources as a strategic, integrated, and coherent approach to the employment of employment, development, and well-being of the people working in an organization. Any organization that recruits based on sentiment and personality will pay for the outcome of such recruitment. Because if you put the right leg in the square hole, there will be problems. Ditto, transition of learning that employs unqualified personnel, the results will affect the product of such institution, as nobody can give what he or she doesn't possess. The major goal of human resources management is to ensure that the organization is able to achieve success through people. It also aims at increasing organizational effectiveness and capability via the best use of the available resources. The of people takes place in the context of the wider environmental setting, including the changing patterns of organization and attitude to work, hence the need for greater organizational flexibility. The changing nature of organization and individual at work has placed increasing pressure on the awareness and the importance of new psychological framework. Mr. Bassan Salazar, for any manager or management to function effectively and efficiently, he or she must be a good team player with thorough understanding of human nature and good human relations to deal with different people. Efficiency is doing the task right, and it's also the factor of relationship between inputs and outputs. For instance, while effectiveness means doing the right task or completing the activities of the organization within a reasonable time. Thus, efficiency and effectiveness deal with what managers do and how they do it. Management functions. The term management to the process, refer to the process of getting things done effectively and efficiently through and with other people. Managers touch their lives in so many ways, and their style of management goes a long way in either making or marrying those working with them. Management is defined as the process of working with and through others to achieve organizational objectives in an efficient and ethical manner. The idea of "I have gotten everything under control" is no more relevant in today's management function. Rather, the need to creatively envision and actively sell bold new directions in an ethical and assertive manner is very essential. Little wonder, sir, Kretner and Kinecki opine that effective managers are team players empowered by the willingness and active support of others who are driven by competing self-interest. Mr. Bassa Salasa, the party corporate, author of the seven spiritual law of success, encourages everyone to practice the law of giving. The law says that you must give in order to receive. That is, if you want attention and appreciation, you must learn to give attention and appreciation to others. If you want joy in your life, you must learn to give joy to others. He went further to say that the easiest way to get what you want is to help others to get what they want. Management functions. To Henry Fayol, managers perform five management functions. They plan, they organize, they command, they coordinate, and they control. However, today's manager and management experts condense these functions into four: planning, organizing, leading, and controlling. Conclusively here, sir, it is important to mention that manager must develop peace, must develop people-oriented organization and skills to be able to get the best out of their staff. They must embrace the four P cycle of continuous improvement: people, productivity, processes, and products. This is represented in the diagram. Management roles. Managers perform more than 1,000 roles every day to achieve the goals and objectives of their establishment. However, for the purpose of this academic activity, this role could be grouped into three: interpersonal role, informational role, and of course, decisional role. A manager takes and facilitates new projects. He or she takes corrective action in response to previous and unforeseen situations. And of course, there's what we call management skills. For a manager to earn the respect of his subordinates and people around him, he or she must possess, display, and utilize some management skills to carry out his function effectively and efficiently. Naturally speaking, there are four basic skills that are very essential for managers, and these are technical skills, that's ability to possess the acclaimed expertise that you say you have acquired as a manager. Human skills, ability to relate with people freely, and of course, ability to understand people in-depthly. Conceptual skill, and the last one is political skill. This is the manager's ability to understand the political scenario of his locality and be able to attune himself or herself to it. It is also his ability to build a power base and establish the right connection for the benefit of his organization. In fact, Mr. Vassar, a good manager must be an ideal. That is any government in power. Mr. Vassar, it is on the understanding of the human resources concept that I came about this topic. Counselor as human resources manager. A counselor, according to Constitution of the Counseling and Student of Nigeria, is any person who holds not less than a bachelor's degree from a recognized institution with an accredited program in guidance and counseling, counseling psychology and applied psychology, and whose primary duties are in areas of counseling services. Article 6, Section 8 says he or she must be of impeccable character as prescribed by the counseling profession. Mr. Bassa Salazar, counselors are not only to provide a realistic vision of what occurs within our organizational sector, but also provide social and national leaders adequate information that will assist them to function effectively within the individual setting without jeopardizing the goal of the organization, which could lead to victimization and final dismissal, most especially in our country and other developing nations where the rights of workers are not guaranteed. The service of counselor within the universal setting is also to provide management staff the opportunity of creating an enabling work environment that will help in tackling the hidden potentials of their workers, which will in turn enhance productivity and commitment. Mr. Vice Chancellor, counselors globally are not trained for school setting alone. Rather, they are trained to be catalysts in all human endeavors. This is more recent. While in the developed countries, counselors are given directing positions, and there is no human organization without a counselor, including their hospitals. The need to manage and tolerate one another will not only promote harmonious coexistence, but also promote global peace. Managing people. Managing people could be dated back to the family memorial, because our forefathers always trained their children to follow the lineage and tradition of their family, to such an extent that values and integrity are placed on their names. Mr. Faisal Salazar, the issue of unemployment was alien to our society prior to the introduction of Western education. And every society was known for their traditions and customs, to such an extent that any deviations were easily noticeable, and appropriate sanctions always followed the deviance in the society. Stealing, robbery, gangsterism, robbery were alien, because the training of the children was a joint responsibility of every member of the family and even the community member as a whole. The extended family structure was very useful in those days, that family was important to family members. You can hardly differentiate the children of some family members from their biological parents because of the communal style, the lifestyle that members operate that time. Mr. Vassar Salazar, Jack Canfield said that without purpose and the compass to guide you, your goals and action plans may not ultimately fulfill you. In other words, to move from where you are to where you want to be, you have to know two things: where you are today and where you want to get to. All these are pointing to one core value,
and our purpose in life. Values are the personal beliefs and preferences that influence our behavior, which are deep seated in our personality. To discover this, one must carefully examine what value is. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, these five steps can help one determine whether or not he or she truly values something, because many a times one doesn't really know or is conscious of what it's really doing. Because value exists at different levels of awareness. Unless you clarify your values, life events are likely to unfold in an haphazard manner. However, once you are aware of your value priorities, you are in the best position to plan and shape life-changing activities. You must know, learn how to think ahead of time. You must have feelings for others and for society. And you must have good communication, effective communication. You must also be able to choose right and to choose realistically. You must also be able to act. After choosing your decision, you must be able to stand by that decision. Mr. Bastian Salosa, we no longer have character, integrity, and moral development in this country. Our homes, schools and government, and society at large are failed in this area. People are no longer bothering themselves about the source of wealth of members of the society. Neither do people bother about the good names of the family again. What is important to them is wealth and power. Mr. Bassanselo, sir, proper management of people at every stratum of our society will ameliorate all these problems. Simpson, a former United States senator, once said that if you have character, that's all that matters. And if you don't have character, that's all that matters too. That is, character is composed of personal standards of behavior, including honesty, integrity, and moral strength. This is the main ingredient that we seek in our leaders and the quality that earns us respect in the workplace. I don't know that in the paper on good parenting, leadership and mentoring, pathway to peaceful cohabitation, argue that leaders originate from this fellowship and it returns to them after the expiration of his or her tenure in office, except traditional rulers. No leader is perpetual as somebody will live before another person can take over the responsibility. Remember to argue that leadership is the ability to inspire other people to work towards the attainment of a common goal. It is the ability to persuade others to seek defined objectives enthusiastically and collectively. A good leader must transmit his feelings and shortcomings to his followers by means of effective communication. A leader of a group in an organization has the responsibility of representing the interests of his group to higher management authority. Mr. Vassanselo, sir, how many of our leaders possess some of the percentage of these attributes? Even the few ones that possess them are not appreciated. How will you explain a situation where the followership will tax their leaders of what is not within their limit before they can put them into position of authority? Meanwhile, when the leaders get there, they will be expecting something or dividend from him. Naturally, he or she will first settle all his indebtedness before remembering anybody. Merit has been thrown into the dustbin, and nobody gets to position of authority without money. Mr. Vassanselo, sir, integrity is the basic ingredient of character. That is exhibited when one achieves congruence between what one knows, what one says, and what one does. When your behavior is in tune with your preferred standard and value, when you practice what you believe in, then you have integrity. However, when you say one thing but do another thing, you lack integrity. Nobody is born with all these qualities. Rather, they are learned from home and being complemented by one's association within the larger society. Remember the age of socialization of home, church, and school. Only peer group is still very influential to today, because peer group still exercises greater influence on our youth. which in most cases were negatively influenced. The home has failed in its responsibility to the children. The church and the mosque now worship money and enslave their members through indoctrination. While the marketplace is where children learn bad behavior and character. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, Adenuga Association defines good parenting as the process of promoting and supporting the physical, emotional, social, financial, and intellectual development of a child from infancy to adulthood. Good parents are those that provide all the above support to their children, while bad parents lack in almost all the above mentioned supporting roles. Good parenting helps children to succeed in life, supports them academically, promotes the development of their intellectual capability, motivates them to learn and achieve their career. All these deter children from all sorts of antisocial behavior, delinquency, and all forms of social vices. A parent, a well-brought up child, would definitely be a blessing to his parents and the entire society that he or she belongs to. The following 9 steps can assist parents greatly in fostering their children's personality and make them blessings to their family and the entire world. Your attitude and action. Be conscious of your love for your children. Adjust your lifestyle. Establish a self-rule. And of course, be consistent in your style of discipline and observance of justice. Avoid harsh discipline, but use it sparingly. Carry them along in decision making. Mr. Vassar, sir, I wonder how many of us here can be assured that all the above mentioned tips are carried out by us. We need to change our attitudes and be interested in the training of our youth rather than allowing them to be used by politicians as thugs and assassins. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, all this can be achieved if our youth and politicians are managed very well by parents and other stakeholders in society. Our politicians should realize the importance of society and the importance of enduring democracy. Our people should also realize that as we make up and we meet our commitments, even small commitments, we begin to establish an inner integrity that gives us the awareness of self-control, courage, and strength to accept more of the responsibility for our own lives. We must realize that when we consistently fail to keep our commitments, we cannot expect to maintain our integrity. There is need for counselors to be involved in school administration so as to assist in the building of its necessary character and integrity needed to build a safe society. Adenuga 1913, a paper on counseling in Nigerian schools, provided that counselors are very essential in managing the school and that we should establish them in primary school because those are the formative stage of the children. Otherwise, they are reported. Remember the saying that KK Latinka Koloku, Commander Batokuma Boyolowini, that we start pruning the branches of the local tree so as to prevent it from falling to its branch to the worship. Mr. Bassan Salosa, some children were brought up in a violent environment where the parents derived pleasure in fighting every morning in the presence of their children. And of course, that's the more recent, why the father of a child lands in Yoruba land and in Africa is abusive. They should live with love and genuine support. All this will go a long way in making our society a peaceful environment. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, counseling services and management of people should not end at home and our system of learning alone. Since human dynamism is continuous, parents naturally express anxiety on their children. And of course, Adenuga Adesanya investigated into the problems focused on parental anxiety and discovered that their expectation of their children is a problem for them. In the same way, they impose a lot of courses on their children without considering the fact that whether those children have the ability for those courses or not. In the same way, Adenuga Adesanya also studied the concept of psychosocial image of the adolescent. And it was discovered that adolescents that are not exposed to social gatherings will end up being withdrawn. And of course, they might not be able to help themselves and achieve greater in life. Mr. Vassar Selosa, counseling service and management of people should not end at home and our institution of learning. It is important that we transcend beyond that place. Mr. Vassar Selosa, I think some of the look at the first apostle resigned to the need by the parents to be interested in the career of their children in a paper titled Career Education and Integral Part of Functional Education. It was discovered that the training and education being provided to African youth before the advent of Western education were career-oriented, where at that time there was no unemployment or wastage of both human and material resources. This assertion was in line with Mackey and Alao, which postulated that the issue of apprenticeship and career guidance, in which career awareness, orientation, placement and achievement were well catered for in traditional African society. These exposure techniques and ideals that can be advantageously integrated into modern practice. So effective was the traditional career guidance system that most of the career-related problems of today, like joblessness, job satisfaction, unemployment, and career confusion, and various forms of occupational induced stress that modern gatherers and counseling are faced today, were none in existence. Mr. Vassar Selosa, Adenuga also conducted a study on the aspect of effective gatherers and counseling service in our secondary in our universities, and once it invested and privatized was used, and it was discovered that the problem of state university differ from that of federal university. The study recommended that functional counseling centers must be established in all our universities with competent counselors employed to attend to the variety of problems confronting our undergraduate students. It was further recommended that the counseling department of our university should be involved in the smooth operation of counseling centers, while periodic counseling talk should be organized by the center in conjunction with the guidance and counseling department. Mr. Vassar Selosa, constant discussion with our adolescent children will go a long way in modeling their character towards themselves and society at large. Mr. Vassar Selosa, apart from the fact that they do not see counselors, the principals of the school, they see counselors as teachers in the school. They force them to teach, and students will not have respect for them because they will see them as teachers and they cannot be part of the disciplinary committee. Mr. Vassar Selosa, child labor and child abuse is another problem that we have in our hands. This is really affecting the development of our children. And that's why Adenuga also carried out research in that area. And we discovered that our parents are using their children for economic gain due to so many problems that we cannot account for. And the most important aspect of problem in our society is the marital instability, Mr. Vassar Selosa. You know, marital stability is a joint venture of all our children if we want our society to be free from problems emanating from uncultured children. Remember, if your neighbors are eating bad insects and you refuse to caution them, the repercussion will also affect you. Adenuga, okay, and Yehenya Shuku, 2016. In a study on marital stability, an example of peaceful and tranquility in our society, identified the following as the causes of marital instability in our society: lack of maturity among our couples, personality traits, poor communication, sexual incompatibility, childbearing, religion, financial problems, work demands, value, and so on and so on and so forth. Of course, couples must always hold family meetings, keep weekly and monthly schedules that create time for both of them to understand themselves, since they come from various home backgrounds. Mr. Vassar Selosa, when home is peaceful, definitely the children will not be maladaptive, neither will they be endangered species. Adenuga, 2006, in a study on youth development and empowerment, partnership to democratic continuity, discovered that Nigerian youth are full of wisdom, knowledge, zeal, and ability to engage in creative activities. But these qualities have been underutilized or channeled to negative direction. simply because of the selfish interest of all of us. Moreover, the family anchor, which Itako was noted for opposing the ideals of the family, has been replaced by nuclear family system, husband and wife, or Nigerian family system of husband, wife, children, and relation of the wife. The school, which are supposed to play a complementary role, are failed in that area. Late Dr. Nami at this school argued that the youths are like a stream with strength and vigor to flow all over, and elderly a lake, though could not flow an hand as the youth, but are filled with experience rich enough to continually nourish and replenish the strength of the stream, so as to continue with the flowing capacity and networking for the development of the society. The lake needs the stream, otherwise it becomes tricky. Likewise, the stream needs the lake as a source of strength, otherwise it will dry up. Mr. Vice Chancellor, how many of our parents are doing what you tell of them to their children now? These are problems that we are facing. Of course, the adolescent problem is another thing that we need to look into and create them for them. Then we move to the role of communication and leadership skills in managing people. Mr. Vice Chancellor, managing people is more of what we say, do, or project in our daily activities. Communication is the key to managing people. But how many of our leaders or managers allow their subordinates to air their views on issues? The need to encourage effective communication with good relations is very essential. Managers should desist from holding information from members of the organization, and of course, learn to involve them in management of the organization. The input of managers of the organization must be sought for, and the reason for certain decisions must also be made known. Mr. Vice Chancellor, managers must have some qualities in order to handle the state of the people. One of them is social sensitivity, activities and social participation, communication skill, capacity for self-management. Many of them to manage themselves very well. You don't get angry all the time. You don't get confused on issues all the time. And of course, you must have strong inner achievement drive. You must believe that nothing is impossible. And you must have high sense of responsibility. That what will people say if they find me in this area? Ability for group work. And manager must have personal charm. Personal charm is talking of your ability to maintain your integrity, your ability to have a pleasant personality, and of course, your ability to carry people along. Mr. Vice Chancellor, both words, action and attitude are function of so many factors, and they speak volumes of our management strategies. Mr. Vice Chancellor, how many managers, as a good manager, you must be free, fair, and fair in decision making. And for managers to always take the following steps to help them in managing people. Lead as you want to be led. Share responsibilities. Stop being Mr. Know-all. No manager knows it all. Stop being a perfectionist. Know the personnel you are working with. Be genuinely interested in your subordinates. Tell people why things have to be done. Treat your subordinates with dignity and respect. Help them in performing the tasks assigned to them by creating a enabling environment. Praise your subordinates, even in public, if they have done well. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, the first management of people is determined by the following: good communication, genuine motivation, exemplary leadership style, and good management structure. Managers of people must also recognize the following statements and apply them in healthy daily life. Least important word, no one is an island. One most important word, we. Two most important words, thank you. Three most important words, if you please. Four most important words, what is your opinion? Five most important words, you did a good job. And of course, six most important words, I made mistakes. I want to go to conclusion. a personal stress. Stress is another area that personal management. And you also agree with me that not all cases in hospitals are biological. Quite a number of them are psychological, quite a number of them are stress-induced ones, and counselors will assist them in making sure that these are done very well. Mr. Pastor Closer, reducing stress is one of the things that presents a serious dilemma to managers. Some stress in organizations are absolutely necessary, and without it, there is no energy in people. As a manager, you must recognize that no matter what you do to eliminate organizational stress, some employees will still be stressed out because you have little or no control over their problems. However, where we will live, personal counselor need to be employed in every human organization so as to assist them. Conclusion. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, let me conclude this lecture by quoting the popular saying that the world is a peaceful place, but the people living in it are the problem. Aye Okoro, our Emmanuel Ashoro. Sincerely, Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, as a counselor and personal psychologist, there is no solution that is hopeless if the right people or managers of people are up to the task of understanding the situation and the people living in that environment. Our problem is greed and useless pursuance of worldly materials. If we can follow our Bible or only Quran dictates and teaching, the whole world will be peaceful. I want to be this, I want to be that. It's only with the grace of God. And of course, what will give the position one day? Let us learn to tolerate ourselves, understand why, how, and when things will be done. Surely, sir, whatever that has a beginning will surely have an end. The only thing that is permanent is the grace of God. Let us all make it a point of duty on a daily basis to turn the life of our fellow being positively and see his mind and happiness that will radiate in our environment. Perfection lies in God, and let us know. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, based on all the issues raised in this lecture of managing people by counselors, the following recommendations are found. One, government as a matter of urgency and necessity is advised to employ guidance counselors into our health sectors so as to handle cases related to psychological, emotional, and psychological needs of trauma of our people. Counselors should be employed in all aspects of our school system, from primary to tertiary levels. All human organizations are advised to have at least a counselor with a functional counseling center to handle all cases related to job stress, frustration, employment, and termination. Courses on human relations should be made compulsory in all our schools, right from primary to secondary. Religious education should be part of the compulsory subjects in all our primary and secondary schools, so as to imbibe the spirit of fear of God in our children. Civic education should also be made compulsory in our entire primary and secondary school, where duties of the government, parents, our children to their parents, and so that will be well spelled out. It is also advisable that period of maternity leave be extended to a minimum of 1 year to be able to give exclusive breastfeeding, and also focus on the training of our children. In-service training on regular basis will also be incorporated in the schedule of our organization, educational and industry. And of course, attention must be given to the mother tongue of every society when planning the curriculum of our primary education to reflect its importance in the profession of norms, traditions, and custom of the various community for colonial development. Acknowledging. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, let me start this session by thanking the Almighty Allah for being my pillar of support all the time. God has been there. I will continue to be faithful to me in your application for life. Sincerely, sir, which of the favor or mercy of Allah will I deny?
shall forever be grateful to you till I depart this world, because you are the beginning and the finisher of all things. I sincerely thank my father, Alaba, the Prince of Adenuga, for believing in me and for being ever ready to give me all the necessary support financially and morally. Even when in most cases he discovered my plan as a young man, he would rather give me and visit my room second day to see the new things that money, I will use the money to purchase. Alaba, my father, it's a pity that you are not here today, but I have the solace in the fact that Almighty Allah has granted you a job of your own and will continue to grant you more of his favor in Adenuga. May the blessings of Allah and start his plan be with you forever. To my mother, who is here present, Alaba, the one who is here, you are indeed a mother. She discovered my potential so early in life, and she was always protecting me from my elders, most especially my Idowu, who was fond of beating me on any frivolous matter. I pray that the Almighty Allah grant you more fulfilling life with good health to further enjoy the fruits of your labor. I say thank you, man. I be able to talk. I am thankful to all my teachers, back from my primary school to the university level. You have all added value to what I am today. I shall be eternally grateful to Professor Titi Adan for his mentoring, tutoring, and piloting me since my inception to this university as an undergraduate student. In fact, what might not be enough, but sometimes to appreciate you, sir, your contribution to my life, you single-handedly brought me into academia when I chose to take up a moment with a man because of the GC salary party that time. But you vehemently canceled like me and convinced my father to compel me to join the university 6 years. Sir, this is the result of your handiwork. Thank you very much, sir. I further appreciate the Professor Kada Ajayi, Professor Tawa Ajayi, and Professor Pio Adesemowo, who was fond of praying for me when I was a very young lecturer. Mama will tell me that you will be dean of a course of education one day, and when you get there, you will find pleasant people to work with you. Mama, sure, your prayer for me is answered. I've come to pass. I thank you very much for your prayer. I thank all the members of the faculty of education, all my heads of department, and everybody. And of course, I thank the National President of our school, Professor Oguyemi, Professor Oladipo, my teacher and mentor, he's the current Vice Chancellor of the National University of Nigeria, and all my teachers at the laptop of the University as well. My appreciation goes to all my lecturers at the network manager for sampling my research teach. Professor CGM Bakari of Better Memory, who admitted me into the Postgraduate School class through Professor Titi Adan. He also offered me graduate and scholarship position in the Department of Garrison and Cancer, Professor Bedouin. But I did not take it up based on the advice of my academic father and mentor, Professor Titi Adan. I appreciate Professor Julio Takiboye, Professor Gesside, Professor Benyanta, Professor Dibola Fale, my supervisor, who is here present, my PhD supervisor, who is here present. Thank you very much for your support. Professor Uwagu, Professor Oziki, Professor Adeyemo, Professor Jaremu, Professor Yamed, and my mentor, Professor CBU Uwagu, who God used for me during the turbulent period of my academic career. Professor Uwagu, you are a non-tribalized Nigerian with God-fearing heart and willingness to see others succeed in life. May Almighty Allah grant you all your heart desire in good health and sound mind, so as to reap the fruit of your labor. I equally appreciate Elijah Dejiwa and Kennedy of Secretariat of Greater Ibadan for their wonderful job. I thank Mr. Yomi, all the members of the Faculty of Education, particularly Dr. Abayo Makinele Oscar, Shesoma Bakonye, and Razak Aziz. These are my academic consultants, whom I consult anytime I get to the Greek world in research activities. I thank you for being there for me all the time. I also thank the Faculty Board of Education for their constructive criticism and support. The postgraduate, the PG postgraduate, the Bola Olukipe, and something like that for you, Kudari, I will appreciate. The duo has been wonderful. I thank you for believing in me and for accepting me for with all my shortcomings. Mr. Adenuga, the master advisor and a lively friend and brother. Dr. Oluwakemiya, Bushra Tadekola, my very dependable sister and workaholic. Give me an assignment. You are sure of his effective execution. Thank you very much for your loyalty and constant advice. All the other private are also appreciated. Dr. Wadeyemi, Dr. Ogutimei, all of you are well appreciated. I also appreciate all the promoters and deans for your support, cooperation, and understanding, despite my shortcomings. In fact, I've learned a lot from you, sir, from all of you. And this cannot be quantified by me administratively and psychologically. Professor Tani, Professor Provost Coach, Professor Ogutimei, Professor Arosoye, Professor G. Adenuga, Professor D.D. Taiwo, Professor Arosoye, and Professor Adenuga.
I thank Professor Adenuga for his mentorship and the mentor for me. Professor Dr. George, Professor Adenuga, Professor Sherin Dintela, Professor Akosepi. Everybody, I thank all of you. And let me appreciate Dr. Adenuga on the part of mass communication and Professor Taiwo, my minister is up in office, for the wonderful and prayer work on this lecture. Dr. Dino Oyele, Akisoria, Balogu, Olabisi, Beleyeju, Wale Oshitoyi, Jibir Unaike, Olabara Koje, Ayetu, Daniel, I appreciate you. I appreciate the promotion of Pastor Ali, Professor of the College of Education, and my brother, Professor Adenuga, the Vice Chancellor of the University of Education. I appreciate you. I want to actually appreciate my Alaba, or my Dr. Kyle Alito, CFRTP, the outer of the woman and former ruler of the professional council, for his exceptional leadership time and he made the position to the growth and development of all the sons and daughters of the room at all times. His philosophy that only the best is good for all the subjects has remained the compass of our navigation to a global height in all demand and neighbors. Oh, Mr. Adenuga, I salute you once again, sir, particularly for your parallel forthrightness and decency, which are acclaimed nationally and internationally. These top values have been revived by some of us, your subjects, as a researcher and manager, who are your descendants. Kadesi, Long Yuri, Eruwato, Eruwato, Nazare Man. I also thank the Lord Father's dear presence for their genuine love, support and understanding. In fact, their contribution to the peace and tranquility of Olabisi Onabanjo University and Gebuland cannot be quantified. Over Abdulazak Adenuga, the woman with of Agawoni, of Okodano, Meji, I salute you, sir. I salute Oba Engineer Isaac Adebe, who came at the door of the little people, Akinle, Akinomo, I salute you, sir. I salute Oba Adenuga Osusami, Alade Omukaku. I also salute Adesi Kosi, Omotayo, Abusalam, Sadele Omishon, Oba Josie Nukubena, Idebo of Renoir, I salute you, sir. Oba Lemi, Oba Lemi, Elizabeth of Desi, Oba Alayo, the Uru of Muru, and all Paramount University President. I thank you all for coming. In fact, let me sincerely appreciate our past Vice Chancellor, Professor Lyle Mukwe, at a very short invitation, Baba was here, and Baba is known to a lot of us as very righteous and very straightforward. Baba, sir, I don't have cancer. Thank you, sir. Yes, as I said, that all the previous Vice Chancellors of our Adenuga University, the Professor Lucio Dimo, Vice Chancellor, Professor Michael Bankole, the Professor Lucio Dimo, Professor Lai Oduboy, Professor Folabi Shiwade, Professor Tola Oshilesi, Professor Shoga Shokola, Professor Wade Adelaiko, Professor Saburi Adebimi Adesanya, who launched me into university administration by appointing me the chairman of the University. I
and member of the university management since 2013. He also appointed me director of education between 2014 and 2016. I also won the National Review of Public Education under his administration. Sir, you shall forever remain evergreen in my heart. Professor Kani Olabisi, our current vice chancellor, under whom I'm serving as the chief of public education and chairman of the university security committee. I thank you so much for the opportunity to serve my alma mater and for believing in me with the confidence you put in me. Sincerely, I'm not the God from your wealth of experience to serve. I thank all the people outside of the university for tolerating me and my inadequacies and allowing me to have from their experiences. Most especially, our neighbor, Professor Professor Onabanjo, highly energetic, dutiful, cheerful, enthusiastic, and always willing to contribute to the development of the university. The registrar, our stunning, elegant, and beautiful Mrs. Obonara Osuso. My brother, Mr. Shedu Makide, university professor, and the acting university librarian, Dr. Ebo Akebode. I thank the members of the newly constituted advisory council of education, under the Ebo leadership, chairmanship of Okumba Babatunde Osokoya, who is their president.
Newly appointed faculty board and faculty council. If you go to my faculty now, they have brought all the materials there. They are working there now. In fact, they started with over 250 bands of the men and every other thing there. So I thank you, sir. I'm not surprised, but Otumba Wato Osokoya, the former head of Army and Secretary of the State Government, is genuinely interested in the development of this university and has got that remain temporary. On behalf of the members of the Department of Education, students and staff, I say thank you, sir, and ma'am. I wish you more success in all your human endeavors. I also thank the entire Muslim community for their spiritual guidance. Our most revered chief imam, Professor Kamal bin Balogun, and the entire deputy imam are highly appreciated. The chairman Muslim community and all their staff are appreciated. The Christian group is also essentially recognized and appreciated. The entire members of the Senior Staff Club, past presidents, presidents, the executive members, and elders of the club are highly appreciated for providing support every day after a hectic official hour. I congratulate you all for your important position in the smooth running of this university. I remember the position paper submitted to Mr. Tabuya Edi Nyerisoya when he assumed office as vice chancellor. I also appreciate the monumental achievement of our members in terms of promotion, attainment of PhD, and professional share. In fact, the appointment of our member at the 800th Inaugural of this great university, the post of Mr. Femi Ogunmoju, the standard of recognition, is a testimony to the fact that membership of the club is not for the drunkards as erroneously believed by some members of the university community. Only the initiates understand the benefits. I thank the executives of the Board of ICON for challenging themselves to attain the peak in all occupations. Dr. Abuja Ade, Abayo Nakinele Officer, and describe our own donor Akimade, Dr. Manager Nikolo, and other ICON members are well appreciated. I commend with you on the demand of your pioneer chairman, Dr. Kennedy Obasan. May he so continue to let you choose. Members of the Yahoo Club, Mr. President, you are here present. And now I don't want to welcome for the vision of everybody. I sincerely appreciate and thank you all. My president, engineer, particularly Ashley, I appreciate you. All the faculty members and our respectable trustee under the chairmanship of Dr. Edward Law, past president, head of the group, Professor Shoba, RCMD, and the host of others. You are welcome to the president. I thank you once again for the invitation and the school and the time of the Holland. And of course, you are the Oshoba and the time members of the Casualty Team. Then I thank all the members of Rotas Law of Nigeria under the Ocean Master of Western Nassau that I was seeing. Rotas Law, are you here? Okay. Let me sincerely appreciate all the unions on campus for showing genuine understanding to the growth
and development of our great university. The great Nasu, the great Sanu, the great Nas, and our own Asu, Victoria Asata. I sincerely appreciate the Chief Security Officer, Mr. Rashid Adetuli, and all the security personnel for their diligence, hard work, and commitment to the security of our university. The great Astolo, FED Assistant Boss Operator, Manuel Operators, all the previous chairmen and members of the Transport Committee of the Square Union government, I also appreciate it. I want to thank all the Square Union President in the last 6 years for their maturity and leadership qualities. From the director, Shoko Ike, Omotayo Babumi, Dr. Williams, and our newly elected president, Comrade Akiba Folami. Are you there? I wish you the best success in the administration. Let me also put on record, I don't appreciate my friend, Adim, Mr. Adim, like now the lawyer, they will leave, for his contribution in my success story. He is indeed a well in this family. Let us all do a for by Sabine Gadeh, Captain Adebisi TJ, from the Duane Yoshova, my confidant and my best friend. I'm always proud of him. I want to thank my brother and everybody. Finally, I want to thank my wife. I will give you this one. I will leave. I want to thank my best friend, Tamar Alina Simodo, Aladdin Mutu Adenuga, my father, Tigo, who is their president, and every member of Adenuga family. Finally, I want to thank my wife and appreciate her, Dr. Faila Sisidola Adenuga, for making the home comfortable. Can you stand up for recognition? For me, and for correcting me with all my top colleagues, I will be very stubborn at home. She is my jewel of intellectual. She is my wife, my sister, my confidant, my friend, and my mother. I love you, and I promise to love you till the time of you. So my queen, by Taisha Kadebo, Adenuga Abadi, Fantana, Adesewa Adenuga, and Selifa Tadeloke, I'm indeed proud of you as my children and my son-in-law. I also appreciate my granddaughter, Siwa Tope, Mr. Pastor, KBC, and the distinguished audience. I thank you for all that attention and wish you very much. But thank you very much.
I declare on behalf of the university that the 84th inaugural lecture closed.